हाय गाइस, कैन यू हियर मी? हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज सीए जय चावला. कैन यू हियर मी? गाइस प्लीज रिप्लाई इफ यू आर एबल टू हियर मी और इफ माय वॉइस इज ऑडिबल. प्लीज कमेंट. So everyone, yes, please tell me, am I audible? Am I audible? Please, we'll start the session in few minutes. Yes, I think everyone is replying. Hello everyone. Okay, so I think my voice is audible. Okay, I'm getting the comments. Good morning everyone. First of all, let me introduce myself. I'm CA Jay Chawla, faculty from Pune and Bhopal from VSmart Academy. And our today's session is based on FR. One second. FR new course. Business combination. And consolidation. Which is basically available, applicable for new course, right? Okay, tell me one thing. Have you downloaded the notes? Have you downloaded the notes? If you haven't the notes, please download the notes from the description. I have already uploaded the notes, and the Google Drive link for the notes has been shared with you in the description box of this video. Please go to the description box and please download the notes first of all. Please download the notes first of all. We are starting the session in few minutes, but once the notes will be downloaded by you all, once everyone is joining the session, and we will start the session then. Tell me guys, have you downloaded the notes? Do you have the notes? Tell me first of all, do you have the notes? If you will see the description of this video, you will get the link to download the notes. Okay, everyone is having notes now. So guys, I'm starting the session. First of all, I'll give you some Okay, I'm starting the session. Right? I'm starting the session. I will give you some inputs first of all. See, guys, in this topic, following Ind AS, these Ind AS are relevant, and we have to read all these Ind AS first of all. Ind AS 27, which is SFS, separate financial statements, right? Ind AS 27, which is SFS, separate financial statements. Ind AS 103, that is business combination, right? Ind AS 103, that is business combination. And Ind AS 110, that is consolidation. Okay, so what will we do? We'll start first of all with this. We'll start the session with Ind AS 27, right? Now, basically, first of all, let me clear you one thing. What is the difference between 103 and 110? Because I observed that too many students are not aware of the fact that there is quite a difference between 103 and 110, right? See, both Ind AS are linked with each other. 103 and 110, both of them are linked with each other. And when we talk about consolidation, right, when we talk about consolidation, definitely we have to read 110 as well as 103 both simultaneously. Understood or not? But for exam purpose, what I can say is this is calculation based topic. And this is theory based topic. This is 103 is basically the calculation based topics. Whatever the calculations are there in these 5 days of session, I assume that I will cover the entire topic in 5 days. Consisting of 2 to 2.5 hours daily, right? So if required, then we'll extend the session for another days, don't worry. But I am assuming that we will cover up in 5 days, 5 to 6 days, right? But please do understand the difference between 103 and 110, guys. Basically, 110, when we talk about 110, the 110 standard is consolidated financial statements, and it gives us the guidance on how to prepare the consolidated financial statements like balance sheets and profit and loss. Basically, this standard gives us the procedure how to prepare the presentation. So basically, this standard tells us the presentation part, right? This standard tells us the procedure to prepare consolidated financial statements, CFS. Understood or not? And what are the basic things we should consider while preparing the consolidated financial statements? We will study under Ind AS 110. But the most important thing is 110 is not telling you that how to calculate the goodwill arising from business combination, how to calculate the capital reserve, how to calculate the purchase consideration, how to make the journal entries under consolidated financial statements, right? How to calculate the non-monetary interest, understood or not? How to calculate all these things, Ind AS 110 doesn't tell you. Instead, Ind AS 103 basically applies on all these calculations. When we talk about the minority interest, that means non-controlling interest, when we talk about the goodwill and capital reserve from business combination, when we talk about the accounting recognition procedure, all are covered under Ind AS 103, right? So basically our question in the exam that 15 to 20 marks question will definitely come from 103, but the presentation part covers from 110 and the calculation part covers from 103. Guys, understood or not? Tell me guys, have you understood this point? Please comment if you have understood this point, if you have understood the difference between 103 and 110. If you have understood the difference between 103 and 110, please put the comments. Okay, so now what we are going to do, since this is the first session, I'll discuss the topics very slowly. Okay, I'll cover the topics very slowly. Okay, everyone is replying. Thank you so much. Everyone is replying. That means you all have understood what is the difference between 103 and 110. Okay, I am getting the comments. Okay, so now since this is the first session, I'll cover each and every point very slowly. Okay, so that you will be able to understand each and everything. Maybe in this session we cannot cover the practical questions, which we will cover in the next session, that means tomorrow, right? Which we will cover in the next sessions. So now I will start the session with Ind AS 27. So guys, Ind AS 27 notes, please open your Ind AS 27 notes. These are the Ind AS 27 notes. It looks like this one. Ind AS 27. Now you must be wondering, when the topic is business combination and consolidation, then why we are discussing this Ind AS 27? When the topic is business combination and consolidation, then why we are discussing this Ind AS 27? See, Ind AS 27 name is separate financial statements. Ind AS 27 name is separate financial statements, right? Now let me tell you one thing guys, financial statements are of two types. If you are having copy, please write down also the important part of the session. Please write down the important part of the session also in your copy. Okay, financial statements. So two types of financial statements are there. Types of financial statements. Basically, there are basically two types of financial statements. First, one is separate financial statements and one is consolidated financial statement. There are two type of financial statement. One is separate financial statement and one is consolidated financial statement. As far as consolidated financial statement, two standards which are Ind AS 103 and 110 applies. Two Ind AS are applies, 103 as well as 110, right? But when we prepare our financial statement on separate standalone financial statement. When I prepare my standalone financial statement, Ind AS 27 applies. Right? Understood, guys? Ind AS 27 applies. Okay, so basically I am giving you one example. Example number one. Suppose there is one company which is A Limited and which is the holding company. And we can also call it as parent company. Okay, we can also call it parent company. And there is another company which is B Limited, and it is basically the subsidiary. It is a subsidiary company of A Limited. Subsidiary of A. There are two companies. One is A Limited, which is the holding company of B Limited, and one is B Limited, which is the subsidiary company of A Limited. Okay, now if A wants to prepare financial statement and B also wants to prepare financial statements. Understood? Now how the A Limited becomes holding company of B Limited? How it becomes the holding company? I am asking you one simple question. Can you please tell me the answer? How A Limited becomes the holding company of B Limited? Can you please give me the answer? How A Limited becomes the holding company of B Limited? How it becomes the holding company? How A Limited becomes the holding company? Can you please give me the answer? Guys, I am waiting. Tell me. How it becomes the holding company of B Limited? Bilal, shares by acquiring control, yes. A Limited has acquired control over B Limited by acquiring equity shares in B Limited. Generally more than 50%. Holding major portion of shares. Yes. So whoever is trying to comment, everyone is right. A Limited has acquired the control. Basically, A Limited has acquired the control by acquiring the equity shares in B Limited, generally more than 50%. Generally, I must say that sometimes it may be less than 50% and then also I get the control. Understood or not? As per 110 consolidated financial statements, as per 110, sometimes in some situations there may be less than 50% acquisition of equity shares, then also I may have the control over B Limited. But for the time being, just assume that I have made the investments. I have made the investments in B Limited more than 50%. Guys, understood or not? So tell me, under A's books, what journal entry to acquire the investments in B Limited, what journal entry we need to pass? Journal entry to acquire investments, that is equity shares in B. Tell me, can you please tell me what would be the journal entry? Guys, can you please tell me? Right now 74 students are live with me. So guys, can you please tell me what journal entry under A's books, what journal entry we need to pass? Tell me what journal entry we need to pass. Can you please tell me what journal entry we need to pass? Investment in B account debit to bank. Sonu, yes, this is the correct entry. Investment in B Limited debit to bank. Jishu, Amrita to bank. Investment account debit to bank. Amal, Anisha. Investment in B Limited debit to PC. To bank. Okay, very good, very good. The entry would be investment in B Limited account debit to bank account. And basically, this is the PC amount. PC, you know what? Purchase consideration. This is the PC amount. Investment account debit to bank. Investment account debit to bank. Very good. Everyone is right. Very good. Investment account debit to bank. So basically, now try to understand. I am coming to Ind AS 27, separate financial statements. Guys, A Limited will prepare, you know what? A Limited will prepare two different financial statements. The one will be separate financial statements and the other will be consolidated financial statements. You know what? Under separate financial statement, in the balance sheet of A, for the time being, I am just creating the T-shaped balance sheet. Please, I am creating the T-shaped balance sheet, although basically vertical balance sheet is applicable. So, in the financial statements, in the balance sheet of A, under separate financial statements, the investments are to be shown here. Investment in B Limited. The investments are shown here. Understood or not? The investments are shown here. Right? The investments are shown here. The assets of A are shown here. The liabilities of A are shown here. The equity capital, preference share capital and reserves and surplus of A are shown here. This is basically the separate financial statements and this is the investment in B Limited under the separate financial statements of A, right? But when we come to CFS, consolidated financial statement, when we come to CFS, A will prepare the consolidated balance sheet of group, basically. Now, when I say group, group means A Limited plus B Limited. Basically, A will prepare the consolidated balance sheet of the group. Understood, guys? So, the consolidated balance sheet of the group will cover the assets of A as well as the assets of B, the liabilities
of A as well as the liabilities of B. I mean to say the net assets of group are to be shown. The net assets of the group are to be shown, but the investment value, this one, the investment value will not be shown. Technically, it gets de-recognized. Understood or not? Technically, the investment account which we have debited earlier here, which we had debited earlier and shown under separate financial statements on the asset side, now we will reverse this investment. We will de-recognize this investment under the consolidated balance sheet. Now you will ask why? Because under the consolidated balance sheet, we de-recognize the investment, that means credit the investment, and we recognize the net assets of B Limited. Basically, what A Limited will do, I'm asking what A Limited will do to make consolidated financial statements. You know what? A Limited technically de-recognize the investment. That means credit. A Limited will de-recognize the investment, and A Limited will recognize the net assets and all net assets of B Limited. Because the net assets of A Limited are already shown in the separate financial statements, so they will continue to be shown under the consolidated financial statements. See, I am not talking about the net assets of A. Net assets of A are already being shown in the separate financial statements, right? In the consolidated financial statement, the same are to be continued. But as far as the net assets of B Limited are to be recognized. So in CFS, what we are doing is we actually de-recognize the investment value. We actually de-recognize the investment value, and we recognize the net assets. Recognizing net assets means asset account debit to liabilities. We recognize the net assets. You know what? At fair value. We recognize the net assets at fair value. And whatever the difference in this, that means de-recognizing the investment and recognizing the net assets of B Limited, any difference, we transfer it to goodwill or capital reserve. Now I will tell you about this goodwill or capital reserve in the next session, in the day 2 session, because this is to be covered under Ind AS 103. Basically, this is to be covered under Ind AS 103. Guys, understood or not? Tell me. So this is basically what A Limited will do to prepare the consolidated financial statements. Guys, are you able to understand? Please let me know. Are you able to understand? Please let me know. Give me 2 minutes. Give me 2 minutes. Please give me 2 minutes. Actually, there is some technical issue. I have to fix that technical issue. Please give me 2 minutes. Okay. Hello. Yes. Yes, everyone has understood. So guys, but still, why we are going to discuss this Ind AS 27? Now I am giving you the main answer of this. Why Ind AS 27 is there, separate financial statement, why we are going to understand Ind AS 27? See, Ind AS 27 applies on SFS. Ind AS 27 applies on SFS. And what it is all about? Basically, Ind AS 27 gives you the treatment of investments which are shown by parent company in its separate financial statements. So what Ind AS 27 is all about? Basically, Ind AS 27 gives you the treatment that how will you recognize the investment. How will you means you are the holding company, you are the parent company. So how will you recognize the investments in subsidiary company, investments in associate company, investments in joint venture company? So basically, if you are having investments in subsidiary company, investments in joint venture, investment in associate company, then what should be the treatment of that investment in your separate financial statements? Ind AS 27 is not going to talk about the consolidated financial statements. Make it very clear. Ind AS 27 is not going to talk about the treatment under consolidated financial statements. Ind AS 27 says what will be the accounting treatment for investment made by holding company or the parent company in subsidiary, associate or joint venture. What should be the treatment and how will you present in the separate financial statements? So basically, Ind AS 27 is technically the I'll not take more than 15 minutes in Ind AS 27. It is technically very small Ind AS. It talks about only two or three basic few basic things. Ind AS 27 talks about two to three few basic things. Okay. So first of all, again I would like to repeat this particular point. Why we are discussing Ind AS 27 first? Because before heading towards consolidated financial statements, we should be able to understand that in holding companies separate financial statements, what should be the treatment of this investment account. Then only we will proceed to the consolidated financial statements. Understood guys? Okay, so now come to the notes portion. Ind AS 27 notes part. Come to the notes part. Come to the notes part. Ind AS 27. See, this standard deals with accounting for investments. In subsidiary company, associate company, joint venture company, and what is written in the individual financial statements of investor. They are saying investor, that means the parent company. I have invested 60% in the equity shares of subsidiary, I have invested 25% in the equity shares of associate, I have invested 40% in the joint venture. So definitely I'll pass the journal entry, investment account debit to bank, investment in subsidiary, investment in joint venture, investment in associate account debit to bank.
So what will be the treatment of this investment account in my separate financial statements? I need to discuss this under Ind AS 27. Okay, so under Ind AS 27, again I am repeating, because I already told you this is the session number 1, this is the day 1. I will be very very slow. I will be very much slow. Acha, tell me one thing, just asking, tell me one thing. Have you ever read this Ind AS 27 and Ind AS 103 and Ind AS 110? Have you ever read these topics, or this is your first time? Tell me, I just wanted to know. Have you ever gone through these three topics, Ind AS 27, Ind AS 103 or Ind AS 110, or this is your first time? Tell me. I am waiting for your comments. Jishnu, first time. Okay. Sonu, have read before. Okay. Anshad, first time. First time. 103, 110, read earlier. Kartika. And it's my first time listening. First time. So tell me one thing. Whoever is commenting like first time for you, what about this session? Are you able to understand the session? Because this is your first time, and let me assure you, don't worry. Although it is your first time, I'll definitely cover all the things which are for exam oriented purpose. Definitely I will cover all the things and you will be able to understand. Don't worry, I am assuring you. Gone through once, Vignesh. Lakshmi, first time. Meghna, first time. Amruta, first time. Maximum students are writing first time. Oh wow. Shivam, did but not remember now. Okay. So you guys are able to understand, na? That's good. Okay. So, don't worry. The session is basically for 2 hours. But if possible and if required, I'll extend this session for another 1 hour, half an hour, or 1 hour. Don't worry. So, read the important points. Since this is the quick revision session, and I have to cover some questions also. So I will read the important points from the notes only. I'm not going to read each and every point. Whatever the important points are there, I will cover that, and the rest you have to prepare by self. Okay. Okay. So this standard deals with accounting for investments in subsidiary, associate, joint venture in the individual financial statements of the investor, that is the parent company. Guys, understood or not? Okay. Now come here. This is very important point for under Ind AS. This is very important point. Point number four. Come here. See, now we are going to discuss the treatment. Treatment of investment in holding company SFS, right? There are two things. First is initial recognition, and one is subsequent
measurement at balance sheet date.
There are two different things. One is initial recognition. Initial recognition is nothing, it is just the it is just recording the value of investments first time. Recording the investments first time, that means it is just passing the journal entry, right?
So what Ind AS 27 says, Ind AS 27 says initial recognition must be at cost only.
That means whenever you are passing the entry of investments, whenever you are passing the entry of investment account debit, you have to pass the entry at original cost, because that original cost is technically the fair value of that day. See, holding company has purchased the investments from subsidiary. Holding company has purchased the investments, that means has purchased the equity shares in subsidiary associate joint venture from the market. Understood or not? We have made the investments and we purchased the shares from the market. From particular third party, we have purchased the shares. So definitely, whatever the price we have paid, that price it must be the technically the day one fair value, and it is the cost also. So initial recognition must be at cost. You have to recognize the investment only and only at cost if there is initial recognition. Now if there is subsequent measurement, Ind AS 27 gives two options. As far as subsequent measurement is concerned, sir, what do you mean by subsequent measurement? Subsequent measurement means on balance sheet date, my investment should be shown at which value? This is basically the subsequent measurement. I want to tell you that at which value I need to show my investments on balance sheet, either at same cost value or at another value. Guys, understood or not? So Ind AS 27 gives us two options. Either measure the investment at cost only. Either measure the investment at cost only, that means this cost you have to continue on the balance sheet date also, continue with the cost only, or you have two options, either this or that, another or that. Either if you want, you can continue with the cost only. That means investment in equity shares of subsidiary, investment in equity shares of associate, investment in equity shares of joint venture. You can continue at cost on the balance sheet date also. You can continue at cost. Or if you don't want to continue with the cost, measure the investments at fair value. Measure the investments at fair value as per Ind AS 109 financial instrument. So you have two options. If you want, you can measure the investments at fair value or not. If you can continue the investments at cost. So it is up to you. It is up to the parent company. What parent company wants to follow? Parent company can measure the investments at fair value also. But for measurement of investments at fair value, parent company has to apply Ind AS 109. Understood or not? Parent company has to apply Ind AS 109. Okay?
And if you remember, if you have ever read the Ind AS 109 financial instrument, there is fair value through P&L or there is fair value through OCI. Whatever you want, you can do it. That means when you are going to apply Ind AS 109 for measurement at fair value, you can measure the investments through P&L or you can measure the investments through OCI. Through P&L means whatever the gain or loss, it will be transferred to your P&L. And through OCI means whatever the gain or loss, it will be transferred to the OCI. Now, I will not talk about Ind AS 109 because this is not our today's topic. Okay. So basically, if you want to measure the investments in associate, subsidiary, joint venture, you have to measure it at fair value or at cost. Guys, understood or not? Now, two important questions are there. I need to discuss two important questions which should come in your mind, which should come in every student's mind. I am going to talk about the two most basic questions which should come in your mind. First, question number first. Sir, from a student's point of view, okay, sir, tell me one thing. Can I apply cost model for associate and joint venture, and can I apply fair value model for subsidiary? That means for subsidiary, can I apply fair value, and for associate and joint venture, can I apply cost, or vice versa? Or can I apply fair value for joint venture and cost model for associate and subsidiary? Sir, can I do this? The answer is yes. Yes, yes, yes. The answer is yes. Okay. So, if you have one subsidiary, one associate, one joint venture, you can apply cost model on subsidiary, you can apply fair value on associate, you can apply fair value or cost on joint venture. Understood or not? Now, tell me one thing again. Sir, I have two subsidiary companies and two associate companies. Subsidiary companies, P Limited, Q Limited. Associate companies, X Limited, Y Limited. Okay. P Limited, Q Limited, subsidiary, X and Y, associate. Sir, can I apply fair value model on P Limited only? That means the first subsidiary. And can I apply cost model on Q Limited only? Can I do this, sir? The answer is no. That means, if you want to apply cost model, apply it on the entire classification of subsidiary companies. That means on the all subsidiary companies. If you want to apply fair value model, apply it on all the associate companies or all the subsidiary companies. You cannot do it like on first subsidiary, you are applying fair value. On the second subsidiary, you are applying cost model. This you cannot do it. Understood or not? Guys, please comment. Have you understood this question? Please comment. Do comment. Then I will proceed to the second question. Second basic question which should come in your mind. Tell me, guys, please do comment, please hurry up. Bilal, yes sir. Yes sir, yes sir, yes sir. Okay. Okay, great. Okay, very good. Very good, very good. Now the second question. Now I'm talking about the second question which should come in your mind. Suppose this is the balance sheet under SFS of, should I say holding or parent company. Okay. under the asset side, investment in B Limited. B Limited is basically the subsidiary. Investment in C Limited, it is associate, say 70%, say 25%. Investment in D Limited, say joint venture, 40%. And investment in E Limited, 5%. Guys, E Limited is not my subsidiary, neither subsidiary nor holding associate nor joint venture. It is just an investment of 5%. I have just purchased the 5% equity shares of E Limited, and it is not my subsidiary, associate or joint venture. Just like the current news, Reliance and Facebook, Reliance and Jio, Reliance Jio and Facebook. Facebook has purchased 9.99% in Reliance Jio. So, Facebook has made the investments in Reliance Jio by acquiring 9.99%. So, whether Facebook is holding any control, whether Facebook is having any subsidiary, whether the Reliance Jio is a subsidiary of Facebook or associate or joint venture, it is nothing. Facebook will just show 9.99% investments in its balance sheet. So my question is, Ind AS 27 applies on which type of investment? I am asking you the question, do I need to apply the Ind AS 27 for all these investments or only for the selected investments? Give me the answer. Guys, I am waiting for your comment. Give me the answer. I have just asked whether Ind AS 27 applies on all these four or not. Ind AS 27 applies on all these four or not? Jishnu, only for selected. Anisha, except E Limited. Good. Only for the selected investments. Only for subsidiary, associate, joint venture, Bilal. Bilal and Anisha, very good. Basically, I will apply my Ind AS 27 here, and here, but I'm not going to apply my Ind AS 27 for 5% investments. Why, sir? Ind AS 27 applies only and only. See, read this first point. Only and only accounting for investment in subsidiary, associate, and joint venture. Now, this E Limited is not my associate, not my subsidiary, not my joint venture. It is my just 5% portion. So the next question is, sir, which Ind AS will be applicable for this one? Sir, for this 5%, which Ind AS will be applicable? Sonu, you are wrong. For all the investments you said, it is not. For E Limited, investments in E Limited, that is 5%, Ind AS 27 will not be applicable. So, sir, which AS is to be applicable? Guys, you will be surprised. It is Ind AS 109, financial instruments. Making investments, acquiring equity shares of another company, it is as good as acquiring the financial instrument. Equity share is a financial instrument, guys. So,
If you are not having any subsidiary company, you are not having any associate company, you are not having any joint venture company, although you are having some investments in another company, then you can apply. You have to apply, not can. You have to apply Ind AS 109. Now come to the Facebook and Reliance Jio deal. Facebook, in its separate financial statements, will apply Ind AS 109. Although Facebook is in America, so basically Facebook will apply IFRS. Okay, so Facebook will apply IFRS corresponding to Ind AS. The same one, Ind AS is 109 or IFRS 9. It is one in the same thing. So Facebook will apply IFRS 9, that means Ind AS 109, to measure the investments in Reliance Jio. Because Facebook is not making the Reliance Jio as subsidiary, as associate, or as joint venture. Understood or not? Yes, Amruta, 32107109 will be applied. Yes, exactly. I commented 109 only because 109 is the main portion. 107 is just the disclosure part, and 32 is just the presentation part. So recognition criteria covers under Ind AS 109. Now see, when I'm going to apply Ind AS 27 for B Limited, for C Limited, for D Limited, I have two options: either cost model or fair value model. See, this is the beauty of Ind AS. When I'm going to apply Ind AS for B Limited, C Limited, D Limited, I have two options. I can follow cost model, I can follow fair value model. But when I'm going to apply when I'm going to measure the investment in E Limited, I can apply only and only Ind AS 109, and that is to fair value. Ind AS 109 never talks about cost. So see, this is the beauty of this Ind AS. Ind AS 27 says you have two options if you are having investment in subsidiary, associate, joint venture. But you are not having any kind of investments like subsidiary, associate, joint venture, then you go to the Ind AS 109 and apply Ind AS 109. That means you have only one option, fair value. Guys, now tell me, have you understood? Because we have completely covered the major portion of Ind AS 27. We have completely covered the major portion of Ind AS 27. Now I am going to tell you only two things. First, about the income from investments. What should be the treatment? And one, there is one question only on it. So tell me, have you understood the entire thing, Ind AS 27, about Ind AS 27? Tell me, guys. Have you understood the entire thing? Jishnu understood. Bilal, yes sir. Yes. Okay. So guys, you have clearly understood, right? So now come to the point. Investment, that is parent company, shall account, investor shall account for its investment in subsidiary, associate, joint venture, either at cost or as per Ind AS 109, that is fair value. That means we have choice to value the investments at cost or at fair value. This is the fourth number point, which was very important, and this was the chart. Okay, we have already read that category wise valuation. Category wise valuation matlab investment in subsidiary, investment subsidiary A cost, subsidiary B cost. That means you have to follow the cost model on entire category. You have to follow the fair value model on entire category. Okay. It is possible to apply cost approach in respect of one category and fair value approach for another category. However, it is not possible to apply cost approach to one subsidiary and fair value approach to another subsidiary. Understood? Okay.
what should be the treatment of income from investment received from subsidiary, associate, joint venture? Please tell me.
You need to answer this, guys. Please comment. You need to answer this. What should be the treatment of income from investment? I, as a holding company, received the dividend from subsidiary, associate, joint venture. What should be the treatment? What should be the treatment? Tell me, guys, what should be the treatment? Deepu John, recognized when right established. Yes, obviously. I am just asking when to recognize. I am not asking when to recognize. I am just asking where it is to be transferred. Where it is to be transferred. Sonu. Sonu has answered. Credit to P&L, recognize in profit and loss. Jishnu, recognize in charge to P&L. Karthik, transfer to P&L when right is established. Vignesh, yes.
So the treatment is always transfer it to P&L of holding company. This is also covered under Ind AS 27.
So Ind AS 27 says whenever you are going to receive the dividend income or interest income or any kind of income from your subsidiary, associate, joint venture, you just need to credit such income to your profit and loss only and only and only and only. Definitely, when I will receive the dividend from my subsidiary, associate or joint venture, I must have passed the entry bank account debit to dividend income and another entry like dividend income account debit to P&L, and that dividend goes to my P&L of separate financial statements. Understood? P&L of my separate financial statements. Again, if I have received the dividend from my associate, subsidiary or joint venture, the first entry I need to pass is bank account debit to dividend income. Bank account debit to dividend income. Then dividend income account debit to P&L. Now the dividend goes to P&L of holding company under SFS, under separate financial statement. So now you just need to learn this. You just need to learn this, that dividend income received from subsidiary company is to be included in the P&L of holding company in the separate financial statements. Okay, in the P&L of separate financial statements. Guys, done with this? Understood or not? Guys, we have done with this. Tell me, guys, we have done with this. So we have covered the most important portion of Ind AS 27. Now we are going to cover one single question on it. We are going to cover one single question on it. We are going to cover one single question on it. Please open the another question book.
You can ignore the numbering of this question. You can just ignore the numbering of the question. Ind AS 27 it is, and please come here. We are going to read this question, okay? And if you want, you can answer the same. You can answer the same, and you can comment your answer on. You can comment your answer before me, okay? Okay. On 1/4/17, Jai Limited purchased 15,000 equity shares of Vijay Limited. There are two companies. One is Jai Limited. One is Vijay Limited. Jai Limited purchased 15,000 equity shares of Vijay at a cost of 26. See this cost. Total outstanding shares in Vijay are 60,000. Guys, it says total outstanding shares are 60,000. So tell me, 15 divided by 60 into 100. How much investment is this? 15 divided by 60. It is 25%. We can assume it is associate company. Basically, the Vijay Limited is associate company. We can assume like this. Okay? We can assume associate company. Vijay Limited is my associate company. So, if Vijay Limited is my associate company, I have to record the investments initially at cost. That means 26 rupees into 15,000. On 31st March 18, fair value of shares of Vijay is 30 rupees, and 31st March 19, fair value is 23. Now, on balance sheet date, there are two different dates of balance sheet. First is 31st March 18, and the another is 31st March 19. On 31st March 18, the fair value per share is 30 rupees, and 31st March 19, the fair value per share is 23 rupees. What is the accounting treatment in the books of Jai Limited? Please do not read the another question. Please ignore this for the time being. Please ignore this for the time being. Guys, please ignore this for the time being. Okay, so tell me, what should be the accounting treatment? Do you guys want to comment, or do I need or should I give you the answer? Tell me without looking at the solution, please tell me the answer. On balance sheet date, what accounting treatment should I follow? What accounting treatment should I follow? Tell me, guys, what accounting treatment should I follow? No one has commented. I think you guys have not. Yes, okay. Initial recognition at cost, subsequent recognition either at cost or fair value. Gain or loss shall be adjusted in P&L. Investment debit to fair value, gain loss. Value at cost or fee. Very good, very good, very good. Okay. Guys, on balance sheet date, Jai Limited has two options. Either to value the shares only at 26 rupees, that means at cost, or I can value my share at 30 rupees. If I am going to value my share at 30 rupees, there will be a 4 rupees gain, and 4 rupees into 15,000, that means 60,000 will be transferred to my P&L or OCI, whatever the option I opt under Ind AS 109, because Ind AS 109 says fair value through P&L or fair value through OCI, fair value through P&L or fair value through OCI. So there are the simple answer is, on balance sheet date I can apply cost model, that is 26 rupees, or I can apply fair value model, that is 30 rupees and 23 rupees. In the first year, there is 30 rupees, that means 4 rupees ka fair value gain. In the second year, there is 23 rupees, that means 7 rupees fair value loss. 7 rupees fair value loss. Guys, understood or not? Yes, 23 into 15,000, 3,45,000. Yes. Guys, understood or not? Arjun Lal, measure at fair value and don't provide impairment. Very good, dear. Very good. See, if I'm going to measure all these investments at cost model, I have the option to apply impairment also. But if I'm going to measure my investments at fair value, I will not apply impairment. Again. If I'm applying cost model, I can apply the impairment standard also, Ind AS 36. But if I'm applying fair value model, I cannot apply impairment under Ind AS 36. Because under fair value, you have already made your investments at fair value, you have already marked your investments at market. So no need to impair the investments. But under cost model, you have to make the impairment also under Ind AS 36. Okay? So this was the particular point. Now, come to the second question. What would be your answer if shares purchased in, guys, this is V Limited. Shares purchased in Vijay Limited are 5,000 only. What would be your answer? If I have purchased only 5,000 shares. So if 5,000 shares are just 5,000 shares, so 5 divided by 60 into 100. That means 8.33%. Now tell me, whether Vijay Limited is my subsidiary or associate or joint venture? Whether Vijay Limited is my subsidiary, associate or joint venture? Tell me. The answer is no. Vijay Limited is not my subsidiary or associate or joint venture. It is just a common investment like Facebook and Reliance Jio. So what should be the treatment? Always at fair value. Always at fair value. No cost model. No cost model. No cost model. No cost model. Okay? You can read the answer. You can read the answer. You can read the answer. You can read the answer, guys. Now what? Ind AS 27 is covered. I think you have got the point. Okay. I think you have clearly understood Ind AS 27. Now, what we are going to do? We are going to start Ind AS 103. We are going to start Ind AS 103 business combination. Ind AS 103 business combination. And now, give me just 4 to 5 minutes break. I am giving you 4 to 5 minutes ka break. I just need a break so that I can fresh up myself. Okay. So after 4 to 5 minutes, I will start this 103. Okay. I'm taking just 4 to 5 minutes. I'm sliding my screen. Okay, so guys, I'm back. There is one doubt asked by Alita Jason. In the notes, point 3, CFS doesn't apply to a company applying equity method. What is an equity method? See, dear, basically, equity method is applied under Ind AS 28, investments in associate and joint venture. So now what is this basically? What is equity method and what does it mean basically? Point 3. See, if I have subsidiary, I will prepare two financial statements. One is separate financial statement, one is consolidated financial statement, where I will consolidate the net assets of subsidiary also and I will derecognize the investments. But if I don't have any subsidiary, but I have associate company or I have joint venture company or both. So if I have associate company or subsidiary company, if I have associate company or joint venture company, but I don't have subsidiary, then also I have to prepare two statements. One, separate financial statement, where I will show the investment in associate and joint venture at cost model or fair value model as per Ind AS 27. And I will prepare another financial statement which is as good as CFS, which is just like CFS, where I will show my investment in associate and joint venture at equity method. That means for subsidiary, I consolidate the subsidiary's net assets with my net assets. But for associate and joint venture, I don't actually consolidate. I will prepare another financial statement. If I don't have subsidiary, I will prepare another financial statement apart from my SFS. And in that another financial statement, I will record the investment in associate and joint venture at equity method. Now you will ask, what is equity method? For this, you have to read Ind AS 28. In short, equity method is nothing. It is just to measure the investment in proportion of net assets value. So whatever the fair value of net assets of associate, and if my investment is 25%, so 25% of fair value of net assets, I have to measure it, my investment. Understood or not? Now another thing, if I have subsidiary, associate, joint venture, then how many financial statements do I need to prepare? Again two. One, separate financial statement, I will apply Ind AS 27 for that, and one, consolidated financial statement. And in that consolidated financial statement, I will recognize the net assets of subsidiary and derecognize the investment of subsidiary, but I will continue to recognize the investment in associate and joint venture at equity method as per Ind AS 28. So I hope now you are getting my point, what is equity method and how it will work. Okay. So this was the doubt asked. This was the answer of the doubt asked by Alita. Okay. So finally, we are going to start business combination. So in this session, we are not having enough time to cover the maximum aspects of this standard. Whatever the time is there, we will cover the basic portion of Ind AS 103. And then in the next session, we'll proceed with the same. Okay. Now see, again, Ind AS 103 and Ind AS 110. Students generally ask, sir, you have covered 103 thoroughly, very beautifully, but you haven't covered 110. Why there is no practical question under 110? So my dear student, basically the question which is asked in the exam, is basically the combination of 110 and 103. So 103 applies when 103 applies for calculating PC, for calculating non-controlling interest, NCI. I will tell you what is this NCI. For the first time, students, I will tell you what is this NCI. NCI for calculating goodwill, / capital reserve, and how to measure net assets of subsidiary company. How to measure the net assets of subsidiary company. So basically, Ind AS 103 applies on this. And apart from all these things, there are some miscellaneous points. There are some miscellaneous points like reverse acquisition, ठीक है ना, common control, business combination, okay, and some other miscellaneous treatments. So Ind AS applies on all these things. Ind AS applies on all these things. Okay? But Ind AS 110 applies on the presentation of consolidated financial statement. That is balance sheet and profit and loss of group. Plus one is presentation part plus applicability part. When I say applicability, that means which company needs to follow 110, that means which company needs to apply, needs to prepare the CFS or not. Basically, the conditions are given under 110. That means what are the companies who are mandatorily required? What are the companies who are mandatorily required to prepare CFS? The applicability norms are under Ind AS 110. And one more point about investment entity. Now this is a new term under Ind AS. We haven't read this term earlier in our IPCC or intermediate days. This is a new term, investment entity. So what is investment entity, and whether investment entity should prepare CFS or not? This is covered under Ind AS 110. So this is the basic difference between 103 and 110. Students, when I discuss the entire 103, generally students used to ask one simple question, that sir, what about 110? You haven't discussed any question from 110. You haven't discussed any practical question from 110. Guys, under 103, all the questions given under 103 are basically the combination of 103 as well as 110. Okay. Okay, again, now, see, I am reminding you once again, since this is just a fast track revision, so I will not cover each and every aspect line by line, because we don't have enough time, no? Right? So we will cover the important exam oriented points only. Important exam oriented points only. It's my assurance that whatever I will cover, that basically is in respect of exam purpose. So don't worry, whatever question they will ask, ICAI will ask, we will cover all these things, but in a fast track, very fast track mode. Okay, so I will not, I'm not going to read each and every line because we don't have limited time. So what is business combination? Basically merging the accounts of two entities. Business combination means basically when the business is acquired, when the business is acquired, that means when the control is acquired by one company of another company, when the control is acquired. Okay, so what is the scope of this 103? We have already understood the scope, this one, ki we are going to read all these things. Okay, now the important thing is Ind AS 103 and Ind AS 110 applies on acquirer company only and not the acquiree. Now who is acquirer and acquiree? Acquirer company means the company who got the control on business of another company. Guys, acquirer company means who got the control, who obtains the control on the business of another company. Okay, and when I say business, here business means net assets. For question solving purpose, just make it simple, like business means net assets. For question solving purpose, just for the question solving purpose, treat business as net assets. Okay, treat business as net assets. Ind AS 103, Ind AS 110 applies on acquirer company only, the company who got the control on business of another company. And business, for the purpose of understanding the practical question, business means net assets. Guys, understood or not? Is it clear? Okay, so Ind AS 103 applies only on acquirer company. It doesn't apply on acquiree company. Now who is acquiree? Acquiree company means the company whose business is getting transferred, whose control is getting transferred. Understood or not? Okay, so what acquirer needs to do? First of all, what acquirer needs to do? Ind AS 103 says acquirer has to apply acquisition method. Acquirer has to apply acquisition method. You remember in your IPCC days, in your intermediate days, there was one chapter called amalgamation, if you can recognize. And under amalgamation, there were two methods. One is purchase method, one is pooling of interest method. One is in the nature of purchase method, in the nature of merger, pooling of interest method. If you remember, AS 14 was that, right? Now under Ind AS 103, there is only one method called acquisition method. It is called acquisition method. And you know what? Acquisition method is 90% similar to that purchase method of CA IPCC. Acquisition method, it is same as purchase method of CA intermediate CA IPCC. Please comment below that have you understood this point or not? Have you recognized that IPCC days amalgamation or not? Please do comment. Guys, please do comment. Okay. Very good. Okay, so you guys have recognized, right? So now, acquirer has to follow acquisition method. Now, what is this acquisition method? Guys, acquisition method has four steps. Maybe a 5 marks or 4 marks theory question may come and they may ask ki, define acquisition method, right? A 4 or 5 marks theory question may come, ICI may ask that what do you mean by acquisition method and when it is to be applied. So acquisition method technically has four steps. Acquisition method has four steps. What are such four steps? See this. This is step number one. This is step number one. First step. What is this first step? Identify acquirer. Identify acquirer. Sir, what is this? Identify acquirer means for accounting purpose, you have to first identify who is the acquirer company. Sir, it is very much easy. Suppose if there are two companies, A Limited and B Limited. A Limited who purchased the equity shares of B Limited, that means sir, A Limited must be the acquirer. Dear, generally your answer is okay, but exceptionally your answer is wrong also. Maybe the B Limited can also be the acquirer. Basically, who is acquirer? Who is actually getting the control? Who is actually getting the control? The entity that obtains the control. There is one term called reverse acquisition. Under reverse acquisition, the company who purchased the equity share is not the acquirer. Is actually not the acquirer. Instead, the company whose shares are getting purchased, that company may be the acquirer, and this is called reverse acquisition. This is called reverse acquisition. The real life case is Idea Vodafone. Vodafone has actually purchased the shares of, Idea has actually purchased the shares. Understood or not? Basically, Idea and Vodafone has merged together, but Vodafone becomes the acquirer company, although Idea has merged all the assets of Vodafone. Understood or not? So, we will definitely talk about the reverse acquisition in the further lectures, in the further sessions, but I am just telling you that first step of acquisition method is to identify the acquirer. Generally, in 90% cases, it is very simple to identify the acquirer. How? The person who is taking over the, who is acquiring the investments of another company is generally the acquirer. But you just need to know actually which company gets the control. The company gets the control is basically the acquirer. Understood or not? Guys, understood or not? And here control doesn't means to acquire the investments through equity shares only. Might be I am getting the control through acquisition over board of directors. Might be the central government allows me or the SEBI allows me to control over another company. Like suppose SEBI allows SBI to control Yes Bank. Suppose SEBI allows SBI to control Yes Bank, although SBI is holding just 40% of Yes Bank. Suppose, I am just giving the example, it is not the true facts, but suppose SBI is holding 40% of Yes Bank, but SEBI allows SBI to make all the decisions, all the operating and financial decisions of Yes Bank. So that means maybe the SBI is acquirer. Understood or not? So this is the first step. First step is identify the acquirer. Identify the acquirer. Although these all are theory points, but very interesting to know about these. Okay. Now the second. Now the second step. Second step is determining acquisition date.
determining acquisition date. Now, what is this acquisition date? What is this determining acquisition date? What is this acquisition date? Guys, acquisition date. This is a very, 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 very important step. Acquisition date, I call it DOA, date of acquisition. DOA, date of acquisition. Acquisition method says your accounting of business combination shall start from date of acquisition only and not before that. Sir, yes, obviously, this is the obvious thing. Yes, dear, this is the obvious thing, but for practical questions, you have to identify the date of acquisition. Now, sir, what is the date of acquisition? The date on which I obtain the control. The date on which I obtain the control of another company. The date on which I obtain the control of another company. Understood or not? You can read this, self-read after the session. You can self-read after, you can read this example after the session. I will not going to read, but I will just discuss this. There may be different dates. There may be different dates. First, agreement date with the shareholder. Another, appointed date. Appointed date means the date on which I have appointed the shareholder as board of directors. One, the obtaining control over board representation. One, the payment of consideration. So which date is to be considered? Basically, on the date on which, generally on which I have made the purchase consideration, I have made the payment, or I have made, or generally the date on which I have obtained the control over board representation, whether or not I have made the payment till. So basically, after the session, you can read this example. You will very well understand. So there are two steps now. First of all, overall there are four steps of acquisition method. One, identify the acquirer. Acquirer is the company who actually obtains the control over acquiree. The second important point is determine the acquisition date. The acquisition date is the date on which control is obtained. Okay, determine the acquisition date. Now, the third step. The third step, very important. Third step is what? Third step is recognize and measure. Guys, recognize means passing journal entry. And measure. Measure means valuing the particular item. Valuing. Okay. So recognizing means passing journal entry. Measure means valuation. So recognize and measure the assets acquired, liabilities assumed, and any non-controlling interest in the acquiring. That means the third step is, see, the first step is who is acquirer? I am the acquirer. The second step is when you have got the control. Suppose I got the control on 1st of June. Okay. The third step is I, as an acquirer, has to recognize the net assets. The net assets means assets acquired and liabilities assumed of subsidiary company in my books on 1st June, on date of acquisition. Third step, I am talking about third step. I, as an acquirer, has to recognize the net assets of subsidiary company on the date of acquisition. Also, I have to recognize the non-controlling interest in the subsidiary on date of acquisition also. So third step is on the date of acquisition, that is 1st June, on the date of acquisition, that is 1st June, I have to recognize the assets of subsidiary company, the liabilities of subsidiary company, and the NCI, if any. What do you mean by NCI? I will definitely tell you. Please give me some time. Okay. And the fourth step. The fourth step. The fourth step.
What is the fourth step? On the same acquisition date, calculate the goodwill or capital reserve because of this acquisition. On the same acquisition date, calculate the goodwill or capital reserve because of this acquisition, and also recognize this. Recognize this means record this. So fourth step is to calculate the goodwill and capital reserve and to record this. Now, please, in our earlier topic, that is 27, if you remember our earlier topic, Ind AS 27, look at this. What was this? What A Limited will do to make CFS? A Limited will de-recognize the investment, and A Limited will recognize the net assets and NCI of B Limited. And the difference between these two will definitely be the goodwill and capital reserve. And this is called Ind AS 103, and technically this is covered under acquisition method. I have already told you this. So acquisition method says, who is the acquirer? I am the acquirer. What is the date of acquisition? Suppose 1st June. So on 1st June, de-recognize the investment to prepare the consolidated financial statements, and recognize the net assets and recognize the NCI. And also, the difference between these two will be the goodwill and capital reserve, and also recognize this goodwill or capital reserve. This is basically the thing which we are going to understand in the practical questions. Okay. Sorry. Yes. So guys, acquisition method has four steps. Identify the acquirer. Determine the date of acquisition, that is DOA. On the same date of acquisition, record the assets, liabilities of subsidiary company, and also record the NCI, non-controlling interest. And also recognize the goodwill or capital reserve. Guys, understood or not? So these are the four steps. Are you able to understand? Okay. Now, I'm discussing what is NCI. Non-controlling interest. What is this? NCI. Suppose there is a company called B Limited, and B Limited has outstanding shares of 1 lakh numbers. A Limited acquired 90,000 number of equity shares in B Limited. A Limited acquired 90,000 numbers out of 1 lakh. That means 90%. That means 90% investments. Understood or not? Who is NCI? Now, out of this 1,90,000 held by A Limited, true, right? 10,000 held by other shareholders, and these other shareholders are known as NCI, non-controlling interest. Why we are calling them as non-controlling interest? Because now A Limited has got the 100% control in B Limited. Yes dear, 100%. Sir, it is 90% na? No. Although I have acquired 90% investment, but by acquiring 90% investment, all the decisions, all the financial decisions, operating decisions of B Limited, I can take only. I don't need to ask the other 10,000 shareholders for any consult. I don't need to consult basically from them. So even though I acquired 90% investment, maybe I acquire 70%, maybe 51%, 60%, 70, 80, 90, 99, but I always have 100% control. So guys, make it very clear. You are having 51% shares, 60%, 55%, 70, 80, 90, whatever you have. But you have, you must have 100% control. And the other 90%, the other 10,000 shareholders are not having any control. And this is the reason why we are calling them non-controlling interest. Now, what does it mean? What does it mean? Suppose there is company called say B Limited. Now me and you, B Limited's 90% shares are acquired by me. That means I will become the holding company and I have 100% control, and rest 10% shares are held by you. That means you are NCI. Now what is the relevance of this 90 and 10, and what is the relevance of 100% control? I have 100% control over B Limited. That means whatever the decision, if I want to take, I don't need to consult you. I don't need to ask you. If you are voting against, even if you are voting against the resolution, it doesn't matter, because I have 90%. I have the entire control. That means I can control entire company totally. Understood or not? But as far as sharing is concerned, suppose if I'm going to dispose of this company, if I'm going to sell this company, suppose me as a holding company, me as a parent company decided that I'm going to sell this B Limited. I will sell this B Limited. Or not entire B Limited, suppose I have decided to sell a particular building of B Limited. I can sell it. It's my decision. I can sell it. I don't need to consult you. As 10% holder, shareholder, I don't need to consult you. But if I am going to sell this B Limited or the building of B Limited, whatever I will get, I have to give you the 10% share. So basically, NCI doesn't have control. NCI has only the right on the net assets and profits of the subsidiary company. So you as NCI cannot control the B Limited. I can control the B Limited 100%. But as far as the share is concerned, you are having right over 10% on the net assets of B Limited. Suppose whenever the B Limited distributes dividend, the 10% portion of that will be given to you. Whenever the B Limited is to be disposed of, the 10% share will be given to you. Whenever there is a loss, the 10% will be borne by you. Whenever there is a profit, 10% will be given to you. Understood? Now tell me, have you understood this NCI point or not? Then if yes, I will proceed further. Please tell me, have you understood this point or not? I will proceed further then. Guys, please tell me. Okay, so everyone has commented, yes. Very good. Okay, so we have understood the basics of NCI, right? So NCI has power, NCI has right to share in the net assets of subsidiary company only, but NCI doesn't have any kind of control. NCI doesn't have any kind of decision making rights. Okay, so what we have understood, guys, please look at here. Golden rule. What is the golden rule? Golden rule is, on date of acquisition, if you want you can write this also, this is a very important point. On date of acquisition, we should consider the following four things. On date of acquisition, we should consider the following four things. The first thing is PC, purchase consideration. Now, if you will ask, what is PC? Basically, the value of investments. At which cost we have purchased the investments? Remember, Ind AS 27 investments must be valued at cost, initial recognition. That investment which we are valuing at cost, initial recognition, is itself a PC. Like, suppose in our example, B Limited was the subsidiary, right? So suppose I took over, I acquired the 90% shares of B Limited and I paid the cash. So whatever cash I have paid, this is PC. Or I paid the cash as well as I issued the shares. Suppose B Limited, I acquired the 90,000 shares of B Limited from Mr. Mehta. Suppose from Mr. Mehta, I acquired 90,000 shares. Basically, 90,000 shares were held by Mr. Mehta earlier. Now, I acquired the 90,000 shares of B Limited from Mr. Mehta. That means from third party, yaar. Understood or not? Basically, B Limited, I haven't acquired the shares from B Limited. B Limited's shares are already issued in the public, in the market, and 90,000 shares are held by Mr. Mehta. I acquired the shares from Mr. Mehta. And I paid 50 lakh rupees cash. This 50 lakh rupees cash is a PC. I issued 30 lakh rupees shares of my own company to Mr. Mehta. This is also a part of PC. That means whatever I am giving to Mr. Mehta, that means cash, or I am issuing the shares to Mr. Mehta, or I am giving the asset to Mr. Mehta, everything will be covered under PC. So the first point, definitely we will thoroughly understand what is to be covered under PC in the next session. But please consider the four points. We should consider the following four things. Okay. Alita, I am coming to your doubt. Please concentrate on this first. I'll definitely come to your doubt after this. Okay. After discussing this, I will definitely come to your doubt. Okay. We should consider the following four things. First, PC. On the date of acquisition, we have to calculate, we have to measure the PC. That means investment cost. Remember, on acquisition date, guys, second, 100% net assets of acquiree means subsidiary, 100% net assets of acquiree. On the date of acquisition, we should know the net assets, the fair value of net assets of acquiree company. We should know the fair value of net assets of subsidiary company or acquiree company. 100% fair, 100% net assets. Sir, why always 100%? Yes, there is always 100%. Even though if I'm acquiring 90% shares, if I'm acquiring 80% shares, if I'm acquiring 70% shares, I have to recognize the 100% net assets. Why? Because I have control. I have 100% control. I have 100% control. Remember, I have 100% control over the business of that company. If I have 100% control, I have to record the 100% net assets. But sir, you have just 90% investment now. Why you are recording 100% net assets? Because I can control the 100% net assets. I don't need to consult you. If I want to sell the net assets, I can sell it. I don't need to ask you. So I have 100% control. I have to record the 100% net assets. Because I have 90% investment only and I have recorded 100% net assets, that means I have recorded more 10%, and that is the reason that 10% is called NCI. I will record the NCI separately so that it makes only 90% net. Understood or not? I will repeat it again in another way, okay? Don't worry, I will repeat it again. So, on date of acquisition, first of all, I need the investment cost. I need the investment cost. Now, please remember the point. I can pick this value from my SFS balance sheet. Remember, I can pick this value, investment cost, pick this value from my SFS investment. Understood or not? Definitely, I must have passed the entry investment account debit to bank. Remember? Okay. 100% net assets, 100% net assets of acquiree. Sir, please tell me again, why 100%? Guys, see, even though I have 90% equity shares of B Limited, but I control the 100% company. I control the 100% business of B Limited. And that is the reason I will record 100% net assets of B Limited. But yes, I understand I have share of 90%, but I recorded 100% net assets, and that is the reason the 10% which I have recorded more, the 10% which I have recorded the more value for this, I will record NCI in my books also. I will record the NCI, and that is the reason the third item is NCI. The third item is non-controlling interest. That is 10% in our example. 10%. I will record the NCI also. Understood or not? Sir, why you are recording NCI? Because I am recording 100% net assets, but I have 90% share. So technically, I have recorded 10% more. So to compensate this, I should record the NCI as a liability side. On liability side, so that it will be compensated. Since I have acquired 90% shares, but I am recording 100% net assets, on the liability side, I will record 10% NCI. So what is the relevance of showing NCI in my consolidated financial statement? Basically, technically, if you can understand, the simple reason is, if I want to sell the building of B Limited, if I want to sell any kind of asset of B Limited, I can sell it without asking you, without consulting you. That means, if I would sell the asset, I can sell it. That means I have 100% control, and that is the reason I have recorded the building 100%. But as soon as it is sold, the proceed I got, out of it, 10% I have to give it to NCI. That means, for 10% out of the total proceeds, that for 10% I have liability towards you. So why not to show you as liability for me? Why not to show you as liability under consolidated balance sheet that I have 100% net assets of subsidiary, but simultaneously I have 10% NCI as a liability. Technically I have 90% share. Understood? Now the last, fourth but not the least, the fourth item is goodwill / capital reserve. I will call it gain from bargain purchase. This is capital reserve. This is capital reserve. Guys, understood or not? We should also value it at fair value. So on date of acquisition, we need these four items. On date of acquisition, we need these four items. We need these four items. Guys, understood or not? On date of acquisition, we need these four items. Clear? Now, suppose A Limited is holding company and B Limited is subsidiary. Okay. Investments purchased 90%, say 30 lakhs. So definitely in my SFS balance sheet, investments in B are shown at 30 lakhs, purchased on 1st of April 21. Now, B Limited has net asset on 1st April fair value. Suppose B Limited has net asset fair value on 1st April is say 29,50,000. Okay, 29,50,000. B Limited has net asset fair value at 29,50,000. Now, how A Limited will consolidate the net assets and NCI of B Limited? Guys, please write down this example first of all. This 30 lakh entry must have been passed, investment account debit 30 lakh to bank. In SFS. Okay, so please write down this example first of all. Write down this example first of all. Okay. So the question is, how A Limited will consolidate the net assets NCI of B Limited? Technically, see, under SFS, A Limited has debited the investments, but now under CFS, A Limited will derecognize the investment. So on date of acquisition, that is 1st of April, A should pass this journal entry. Which one? Net assets of B account debit, it must be 100%. That means 29,50,000. Net assets means assets and liabilities. Okay. Asset account debit to liabilities. In short, this net asset to NCI account, obviously it is 10%. So NCI is 10% of which one? 2,95,000. Proportion of net assets. In the next session, I will tell you how the NCI is to be calculated. But for the time being, make it simple. NCI is calculated as a proportion of net assets. If the total net assets are 29,50,000 and NCI is 10%, that means NCI's value is 2,95,000. Okay. Two investments, 30 lakhs. Basically, see what we have done. We have recognized net assets of subsidiary. We have recognized NCI in subsidiary. We have derecognized investment. Sir, why derecognize? Because earlier in SFS we have recognized the investment. Now, what is the difference? 29,50,000 minus 2,95,000 minus 30 lakhs. The difference is 3,45,000 on the debit side. So 3,45,000 difference is called goodwill account. And it is the balancing figure, which is called 3,45,000. Guys, this is the goodwill account. See, if you consider this chart, first thing, second thing, third thing, fourth thing. First thing, investment value we need. We need net asset value. We need NCI value. We need goodwill value. So finally, this journal entry. This is the basic to understand the entire chapter of business combination. Although institute is not going to ask the journal entry, but I must believe that basically we can make your concept strong by passing the journal entry only. Okay, so I'm assuming that your concepts will be basically strong only when you understand the journal entry portion. Journal entry portion. Okay, now alternatively, in questions, exam questions, we generally don't need to pass journal entry. In exam question, we make the calculation like this. See this. What you have did? 2 NCI and 2 investment. These two accounts have been credited. Can I add these two? Can I add these two? So this is the alternative, basically. Investment cost, basically the PC is 30 lakhs. Add by 10% NCI, 2,95,000. See this, I have added these two. दिस इज 32,95,000 एज रिड्यूस्ड बाय 100% नेट असेट्स. नाउ व्हाई आई हैव डिडक्टेड, बिकॉज द नेट असेट इज गेटिंग डेबिटेड एंड दीज टू अकाउंट आर गेटिंग क्रेडिटेड. सो क्रेडिट माइनस डेबिट एट फेयर वैल्यू 30 lakhs. सर वेदर द फेयर वैल्यू विल बी गिवन, यस डोंट वरी. सो सी दिस, एक्चुअली यू हैव इनकर्ड दिस मच टू अक्वायर द कंट्रोल. ए लिमिटेड इनकर्ड दिस 32.95 टू अक्वायर कंट्रोल. सर वाई 32.95? A limited has just incurred 30. No dear. A limited has incurred 30 lakh. That means outflow. And A limited has accepted the liability of NCI as 295. So I have incurred 30 lakh. Giving 32.95, we acquired. Sorry, this is not 30. Sorry. This is 29,50,000. Yes. So by acquiring 29,50,000, we have paid more. Can you understand? We have paid more. We got 29,50,000 net assets. But we incurred, to acquire this 29,50,000 net assets, we incurred 32.95. So technically, we incurred more. So we have paid more value. The more is called goodwill, which is 345. We have paid more. Vice versa, we have paid less. That means gain. We have paid less and we got more. We have paid less. This is called gain from bargain purchase, capital reserve. Here, we got less and we paid more, we discharged more, we incurred more value and we got just 29.50. We have paid more. That means whatever we have paid excess, it is not our loss, it is our goodwill. Why we are creating goodwill? We are assuming that in future we will take the benefit of this 345. Okay, but vice versa situation, when we have paid less and we got more, it is called gain from bargain purchase, and gain from bargain purchase generally transfer to capital reserve. Guys, understood or not? So this is the alternative of that journal entry. Guys, with this thing, I am going to conclude the session. So technically, we have started the session at 9:30. Effectively, we started the session at 9:40 or 45, and now I am completing the session at approximately 11:55. So guys, with this session, with this thing, I am concluding the session. You just need to revise all these things. If you want to read from notes, you can read the notes also. I will not tell you that you don't need to read. If you want, you can read also, don't worry. If you want, you can read also all these things, all these points you can read also. Also, this is your homework part. This is your homework portion. We will definitely discuss it in the next class. Okay. So now coming to the doubt. Alita Jason, if 10,000 shares are board of directors and have decision making power, then even if A acquires 90%, it will still be NCI. Now see, if suppose out of 1 lakh shares, board of directors have 10,000 shares and board of directors have been given entire controlling power by central government or by any act, whatever it may be, then in that case, board of directors are having the control and A Limited is NCI actually, and A Limited doesn't have any control in that case, and in that case A Limited will not consolidate the B Limited. Understood guys? So this was the answer in respect of doubt asked by Alita. Okay, so Alita, please do comment if you have understood this. Please do comment. I'm waiting, dear. Okay. So guys, can I conclude the session? And please tell me, before concluding the session, please tell me your experience of this day one class, day one session. And please give your feedback. Even after the session becomes over, you can give me the feedback personally or on my Telegram group, if you are connected with me on Telegram group. So guys, please do comment your feedback, what you have felt like in day one session. Have you understood the session? Are you satisfied or not? Jishnu, in the normal course where the board of directors are elected through casting of votes. See, in the normal course, if the directors are elected through casting of votes, then obviously in that case, board of directors are not having so much control. Definitely, we can assume that the board of directors in that case will not have so much control until and unless board of directors have been given the specific control by central government or by any other act. So, considering this thing, I have given the answer. Okay. Okay. So guys, I just need your feedback so that I will be motivated for this, and for the further classes I will be motivated. So guys, thank you so much. I want to tell you that this recording, I'm doing this recording from my home, obviously, in this lockdown situation. This is basically my home recording, my studio recording, which I have basically created this studio for, especially for the recordings. So guys, we will meet tomorrow again at 9:30, right? We will meet tomorrow at 9:30. If you want, you can read from the book. Also, it is your homework. You can read this and I will discuss this tomorrow, and further, we'll discuss further points also. Okay? So guys, thank you so much. With this quote, I am signing off. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. Jai Mata Di. Allah Hafiz. Thank you.